watching. Tonight, we're in the Gospel of John. This is, of course, the 69th exposition of this book. We're going to be in the last three verses of chapter 5, verse 45 through 47. Now, a few words about Jesus as we commence, because these are going to be some strong words that he says. Jesus never speaks unnecessarily harshly or with the intent to do harm. He was harmless as well as holy. And he really didn't come to break a bruised reed or quench a smoking flax, but his enemies had no idea about these things. He wasn't mean as men think of mean when he addressed wicked people and deceivers. The law of kindness was in his tongue, but not when he talked to his enemies, unless it was that he subdued it so they wouldn't be destroyed by it. In divinity, there's a certain unquestionable aversion to iniquity. It's there, especially the unbelief. It doesn't go away. Doesn't make any difference how long you're in Christ. God's repelled by iniquity. And Jesus was too, and if it remained in his presence, he did say something about it, and he'd do something about it. That's the way Jesus was, and this kind of Jesus is, not many people are familiar with him, it seems, at any rate today. He didn't come to judge the world, but he didn't tell his enemies this. They probably thought he had. When he confronted unbelief, like it's in our text, he would address it. No uncertain words. It'd be very, very clear. It would aggravate the people who heard it, but they couldn't contradict it, effectively contradict it at all. When he finds things in his people that he doesn't like or care for, he'll inform them about it. And I'm thankful he does. We have record in Scripture, just in case you're not sensitive enough to hear the voice that says, still small voice, there's in Scripture, it says records, so you know what the kind of things that he says. To his disciples, he'll say such things as, and this is for those who tend to worry, and this way, where is your faith? That's Jesus asked that. Amen. To his disciples, where is your faith? How about this? Said this to one of his disciples, Peter. Get thee behind me, Satan. Huh? He said that to Peter.
Yeah.
Again, he said, oh, faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? That's what he said at the bottom of the Mount of Transfiguration when they met the other nine disciples. How is it you do not understand? He said this to his disciples. Yeah. Again, when they were talking among themselves, why reason ye these things in your hearts? This is how Jesus is, and this is the Jesus we aim to preach. We don't want to be lopsided, but I don't know, you can't be lopsided when you're talking about Jesus. Jesus, he adapts himself, his responses and his words, to the people he's talking to. He doesn't talk down in the valley like he does on the mountain. He doesn't talk in the synagogue to the Jews like he did when he was with his disciples in the upper room. See, he doesn't talk the same way. He didn't hesitate to tell his enemies what they were. Even so, ye also, you outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within you're full of hypocrisy and iniquity. He said that face to face.
That's right.
To some religious leaders that nobody else knew that. They were this way. O thou Capernaum, which art exalted into heaven, shall be thrust down to hell. That's Jesus made his headquarters at Capernaum.
Yeah.
He told him, you're going to go to hell. Mm. How is it you do not understand? He said to his disciples. To the lawyers, he said, woe to you, ye also, ye lawyers, for ye laid men with burdens grievous to be borne, and ye yourselves touched not the burdens with one of your fingers. See, that's Jesus. That's how he talks. Now, you can't copy that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
This is language that was driven by what he comprehended. And when you speak, anyone speaks what sounds like harshly, it's got to be because of what they comprehend.
Yes. Yeah.
If you're worried about offending somebody all the time, you'll fall into a snare after snare.
Yeah.
You can't do that. You've got to ask for grace to speak according to the circumstance. Mm-hmm. If you're facing obstinance, you don't come with honey in your mouth.
That's right.
Yeah. If you're facing tenderness, you don't come with a hammer in your hand.
Yeah.
See, this is the way. There has to be discernment. You see, you can't really work for Christ unless you live in an active consciousness of Him and walk with Him. Otherwise, you're just copying somebody else, and it's no good. Well, this is the kind of text that we're going to have before us. That's why I wanted to prelude it with those remarks. Here's the text. His last words to this group of people that thought he did the wrong thing and healing a crippled man on the Sabbath day, and he was blaspheming when he said God was his father. To the people thought that. This is the last words he said to them in this text. Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust. For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me. For he wrote of me. But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words?
Yeah.
Now, this is a very weighty text.
Yeah.
And you may, what I'm going to say tonight, you may have thought of it yourself, I don't know, but this is something that's growing on me. What I'm going to talk about tonight is a reality that's growing upon me more and more. I'm growing more and more discontent with pretentious and powerless religion. I'm getting more and more, I can't tolerate it. And more I want what people in Scripture had that were walking with Jesus. That's what I want. I want to be able to assess and talk like Jesus did in my own measure. Do not think. See, now Jesus is the only one that can tell you to stop thinking about something. This is Jesus. Don't think about that. You ever try and make that happen? Do not think about this. Other versions say, put out of your minds the thought. So you get the idea this thought has been pitched in there.
Uh-huh.
See?
Yeah.
Throw it out. Do not suppose, do not imagine, do not be thinking. Put out of your mind the thought and do not suppose as some of you are supposing. See, now if you're not careful, you'll end up supposing or having suppositions or theoretic views or guesswork.
Yeah.
Don't think that. And this is the only time Jesus said, do not think. There are four other occasions when he used a similar expression, think not. See?
Mm-hmm.
Who but Jesus could say something like this? Think not. Don't think about that. He questioned the reasoning of men. Why reason ye among yourselves? Why are you thinking this way? Why reason these things in your heart? See, that's thought. He's talking about thought there. So this is, we're going to talk here about legal or courtroom talk. This is the kind of talk we're talking about here. "Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. Don't think I'll say things against you to the Father. Don't think I'll be your accuser before the Father. Don't think I'll bring charges against you in front of the Father." It's a resting word, isn't it?
Yeah, amen.
The day of judgment is when everyone will give an account of themselves to God. This accounting will not be the person's personal assessment of what he is and what he's done. It's going to be a response to an accusation or a commendation. This is the day of judgment. You're going to say, "All right, now, tell me what you think about what you did." That isn't how it's going to be. He's going to tell you what you did and tell you what you didn't do, and then you got to answer.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's going to be the day of judgment. That's what it's going to be. So if you're kind of sensitive about doing that now, won't you? This is going to happen. As I mentioned, this is legal or courtroom talk. Now, Daniel prophesied of the time that this is going to happen. God revealed to Daniel this, what we're talking about here, was going to happen, that Jesus himself wouldn't be the one that brings the accusations. Here's what Daniel prophesied. Daniel 7:22, "Until the Ancient of Days came and judgment was given to the saints of the Most High God, and the time came when they possessed the kingdom."
Yeah.
So the accusations are going to be made by the saints.
Yeah, that's right.
And the commendations. Mm-hmm. At the top, it's reflecting God's mind through Christ, through the saints. Now, this actually happened in Corinth. Paul told them about this time. He said, "Don't you know that the saints are going to judge the world?" See, he told them about this time. The saints are going to judge the world. He said, "Shouldn't you judge in such small matters now?"
Yeah.
So you say, I just don't like to make a judgment in this. You got to make a judgment in it. You got to make a judgment in this. The point is, you can't make a condemning judgment. You can't consign anybody to hell, and you can't consign anybody to heaven. You can't make a judgment in that sense.
Right.
But you've got to make a judgment. Get tuned up.
Yeah.
Get tuned up, because on the day of judgment, the saints are going to judge the world. So they better be learning how to do it now and entering into it. Some thought, isn't it? There was a church, Philadelphia was a church that was persecuted by the Jews, whom Jesus called the synagogue of Satan. And here's what Jesus told that church at Philadelphia. "Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee."
Yes. Amen.
They didn't know it while he was in the world. They talked against you while you were in this world.
Uh-huh.
They criticized you when you were in this world. They made life a little harder for you when you were in this world. But don't fear. I'm going to make these people come, and before an assembled universe, they're going to bow their knees before you and admit you're the one I loved, not them.
Yeah.
That's what he said to them. Now, if you haven't found refreshment in that yet, believe me, the time will come when you'll be refreshed by knowing that that's there. Now, you want a picture? The prophets, Moses, the prophets, John the Baptist, the apostles, and others sent by God, being appointed to judge the ones that rejected them. They left this world. It looked like their enemies won. That's when going to take place. Moses will judge the Israelites he led.
That's right. Yes.
He's going to bring up that incident at the foot of Mount Sinai. The murmurings all through the wilderness, provoking God 10 times and refusing to believe. See, that's all going to be made public. And Moses is going to accuse him. That's what Jesus is going to say. Moses is the one going to bring the accusation. The prophets will judge the ones to whom they were sent. Jeremiah judged the ones that had him thrown in a pit. The ones that told him to stop prophesying. The ones that tore up his book. It's not over yet. It's not over yet. Zechariah was slain between the by the altar. Jesus is going to judge the ones that did that.
Yes, amen.
Herod's going to be judged by John the Baptist.
Yes.
Me? It's like those that criticized John the Baptist said he had a demon. John the Baptist is going to judge him. This is how the kingdom of God works. Everything's leading up to that. The apostles will judge all those that neglected their word or didn't believe their word or acted in contradiction of it, even though God inspired them, God sent them, God told the church, he says, these are the foundations. You got to listen to what the apostles said. If you don't know what they said, learn what they said, because this is what you build on, what they said.
Yeah.
If people didn't do that, they'll be judged by the apostles. Now, there was a foretaste of this kind of judgment was occurred in Corinth when they expelled that fornicator from their presence. He didn't say pray for him. He'd been going there. He'd been exposed to all the gifts the Corinthians had. He'd heard all the admonitions the Corinthians heard. He'd heard the gospel that they heard. And he still lived with his father's wife.
Yeah.
They had to kick him out.
Yes.
Uh-huh. That was judgment.
Yes. Yeah.
That was a prelude to this, what we're reading about right here. When Paul told him, purge out the old leaven. Get it out of there.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Old leaven was people. Was there were people. They were inhibiting the whole entire assembly. They were the ones that caused the divisions that were there. See? They're the ones that taught them that there wasn't any resurrection of the dead. Get rid of them. Yeah, hell's not worth it. Believe me.
Amen.
It isn't. This is part of the crown of righteousness. You ever wonder why it's called a crown of righteousness? Think of a crown of righteousness as enabling a righteous judge to execute judgment.
Amen.
So you think that's what a crown. This is what a crown. It's not like a wreath, like a Greek wreath. That's not what it's a crown.
Yeah.
That has to do with reigning and ruling of righteousness, righteous judgment. The saints are going to judge the world.
Yeah.
What a thought.
Amen.
See, this is why we don't avenge ourselves.
Uh-huh.
This is why we don't render evil for evil.
Mm-hmm.
It's not time yet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep, that's right.
But our day's coming.
Yeah, right.
Amen.
You can't afford to enter into judgment ahead of time about the end. And this isn't the time yet.
Yeah.
But the time's going to come when the saints are going to be judged. That judgment, that's what the script Daniel said, the time came.
Yeah.
When the judgment was given to the saints. All right, you... Just like everyone will be gathered there, the saints will, angels will have separated the wheat from the chaff, will all be there, and God will look at the saints and say, this is your hour.
Yeah, yeah.
Proceed now. We're not hamstrung by time or anything.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't recompense,
right.
Retaliate.
Uh-huh.
We don't do this.
When you think about it, this makes the most perfect sense.
Because the Christ's Spirit now, His Holy Spirit is in you,
yeah.
And you're navigating through this world, and everything you touch,
yeah.
Someday you will have experienced, so you will be the perfect judge.
That's right.
Yeah.
See, and until then,
mm-hmm.
This is like a little space. It's like space to repent. For sinners, it's space to repent.
Yes. Amen.
For us, it's time to be patient and to wait.
Yes.
Wait till you are given the judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Then we'll enter into it fully. So Jesus said, I don't think I'm going to accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, Moses,
mm-hmm.
in whom you trust. And when you think of how Moses suffered,
oh, yeah.
You think you've got a hard job. He was faithful in all his house. But his house wasn't faithful to him at all. God did not. God's not going to overlook that. When God takes a person and puts them over a group of people or a person or someone else and they don't pay any attention to it, it's logged in the books.
Yeah.
And it'll be brought up on the day of judgment.
Amen.
You know, this will give you peace if you receive it. Yeah.
Just forget things like men do.
That's right.
You know, we'll forget stuff and we'll just go on.
Yeah.
And it passes. But see, God, that's not God's nature. For one thing, he doesn't forget. He can't, you know, he's able to remember.
Mm-hmm. That's
but
right.
It's not right for him not to let things just go.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Yeah. Whenever he talks about Moses, in some respect, that's a synonym for the law.
That's right.
Because when they read Moses or whenever they sit in the seat of Moses, they're talking about the law itself.
Mm-hmm.
And then I pair with that the scripture said, he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. So the law taught men what was good and what was right, and they didn't do it, and it made it sin to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so it condemns and... You're right, both the person of Moses and the message of Moses.
That's right. See, until here's how the people of God, they're given enough information and they're given enough power they can live this way.
Yeah.
They can endure oppositions and contradictions and things that make you even weep. They can take it. And there's two things that will help them take it. First of all, there's space to repent and they may change.
Yeah.
So you got that possibility. But in the end, I will have a direct hand in rectifying this.
Yes.
See, and those two things will enable you to pass through without acting foolishly.
Amen. Now, this crown of righteousness, that's the most satisfying explanation I've ever heard of it.
Yeah.
You may have dealt with that in the Revelation commentary, but I don't remember it.
Yeah.
But see, now this is the crown. You know, we've been taught to think it's just a crown that sit on your head.
Mm-hmm.
But this is more functional to think of this
way. That's
this
right.
This is the time when actually you're given the, it's a symbolic, but it means for us, that's the time you've been given to rule in righteousness like the Lord's been
that's
doing
right.
all this time.
Mm-hmm.
It's really gratifying.
So you see, you add this to your view of living godly.
Yeah.
That it stretches off into eternity, which means none of your labors will be in vain.
Mm-hmm.
None of your words will have been spoken in vain. It may look like they were, but they will not have been spoken in vain.
Yeah.
And every wrong that was ever committed against you will be rectified at that time.
Yes.
Until then,
you
can't rectify it.
Amen. And that's
included in it. But every right, every time someone has assisted you and has blessed you and has enhanced your understanding, you will be able to testify and point that out and say, look, this is the one here that brought me all this wisdom and knowledge, and it'll be a time for a great blessing too.
Then the person will respond.
Yes. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Actually, we are not equipped right now.
That's right.
To make
that's right.
the judgment that would perfectly reveal the Lord in us.
Yeah.
It's reserved to that day whenever we've put away the things that would hinder or weaken us, if you will, cloud our judgment. And what'll be seen in that day is the judgment of Christ through his saints.
Amen.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
It's God, Christ, saints.
Yeah, that's right.
And everything that God would have done, Jesus does. Everything Jesus does, the saints will do it.
Yes, amen.
Passes through, which means flesh is completely out of the picture at that time. Completely out of the picture. Brother Justin?
Yeah. You know, it brings a sense of peace to know that everything's going to be righted one day.
That's right.
You know, have you ever heard somebody say, how could you let them get away with that? Or how could he get away with that?
He did.
Well, they're not convinced that no one's going to get away with anything.
That's right. Amen.
They're not convinced of that.
Amen.
So when you're convinced of that, it brings this peace.
You think?
Amen.
It says, there is one that accuseth you to go to the Father. You're not going to accuse to their faith, it's to the Father. The Father, this is what this man did here. Moses will accuse, this is what they did. God knows it already. See, but he's, now he's handing the judgment down to Moses for Israel. And think about this, that he was there when they rioted at the bottom of the mount. It looked like years later that maybe only 3,000 died and the rest got by. No. Didn't get by with it at all. He was there when they broke the law. And at the day of judgment, he'll bring this up. He'll bring up these wanderings in the wilderness. He'll bring up these murmurings. He'll think discontent with manna, longing for to go back to Egypt. See, he'll bring all this up, and then they're going to have to answer. And their mouths are going to be stopped. They're not going to be able to answer. But they'll be required. Speak up now and give an account. Why didn't you take my money to the bank? See? Moses is going to accuse him to the Father, make the formal accusation. The people then are going to have to answer to God for what Moses said they did. And this will go down to all the saints. The saints, in each one in their measure and according to their influence and their capacity and time they lived, how extensive their influence was. See? It's all going to be rectified. There'll be some people that were just all they really. There'll be some mothers there that they just managed their household, and some of their children maybe were submissive and some weren't. They'll have to answer.
Yes, amen.
In the day of judgment, for why they conducted themselves that way towards someone God put over them. Even children, that's right. They're going to have to give an account.
Yes.
So it's good to know that ahead of time so you can prepare.
Amen.
There's a song we sing, and it's the first sentence that says, prepare to a strict account to give. I like it. Now Jesus is speaking to them who refused to believe on the one of whom Moses prophesied. And they broke the law as well. And so on the day of judgment, they're going to have to account for why they didn't believe what Moses said about Christ. That'll be like the crowning responsibility. Then he says to them, had ye believed Moses, you would have believed me. For he wrote of me. See, only Jesus could make that kind of an assessment, right? But he did, unwavering accuracy in it. This group of people he's talking to were noted for being meticulous about obeying the law. This was kind of their mark. They went out, they were separate people, lived for the Lord, apparently, devoted themselves wholly to Moses. In fact, they said they were Moses' disciples. It's called the Law of Moses, not because Moses originated it, because Moses gave it.
Yeah, that's right.
God gave the law to Moses. Moses gave it to the people. So it's called the Law of Moses, the law of the man that gave it. Paul referred to his gospel. The gospel originated with God. He gave it to Paul, and it became his gospel.
Yeah, that's right.
He was responsible for declaring it. See, the law is given to Moses. He was responsible for declaring it. So it was, to the extent he declared it, was the law of Moses. See, so you've been given something from God. There's no such thing as a member of the body of Christ that hasn't received something. There's no such thing. Now you're responsible for what he gave you. And it can be called, it belongs to you in a sense. The Law of Moses. Now let's take a look at what Moses did and say. Now Jesus said, if you would have believed Moses, you would have believed me.
Yeah.
All right, Moses details for us the creation. And he even tells you how long it took. And 7 cycles of evening and morning. 6 cycles of morning and evening, the 7th when he rested. Now, creation of necessity means you start with nothing. That's part of what creation is. You start with nothing, all right? Boot the entire evolutionary hypothesis, even the theocratic evolution, pitch it out, because it starts with something. How dare a Christian believe that? And the church is really loose on this. Really loose on this. Too many might-be's, could-be's, lengthy creation years, you know, all this sort of thing. We have a precise revelation of the creation that came through Moses.
Amen.
Can you imagine if the creation years were like 1 million or 1 billion years, and Adam's created on the 6th day, he could have been 1 billion years old on the 7th day. This is a bunch of lunacy. It deserves no respect at all. It should not, no child should be subjected to this kind of teaching. Gave us a detailed account. He told, yes?
It's been pointed out that another error with that is that you have to account that death was in the world before sin entered. If the evolutionary cycle.
That's right, that's right.
Death was in the world before sin.
That's right, amen. So creation wasn't an evolutionary process. The entire universe, all its stars, galaxies, planets, on Earth, all the inanimate things, all the living things, plant life, animal life, all of it was created in a full-grown state. There were no seedlings in the plant world. There were no baby animals and no baby men. They were all created in a complete, adult, fully grown state. There was fruit on the trees. Now this, Moses gave this record. Very thorough. Now the reason it's important is because the new creation is that way too.
Yes.
In the new creation, God starts with nothing.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
He doesn't like polish up what you were.
That's right.
Or reform what you were.
That's right.
That's not the new creation. See, if you want to know what the new creation is, you got to go back to Moses' account of the creation. It started with nothing. Darkness and chaos. And he, out of that, he made something.
Amen.
That did not exist. What you are in Christ, so far as you were concerned, did not exist before you were in Christ. Not in any measure.
Amen.
Not in a little microscopic measure even. You did not have one spark of this life in you.
Amen.
Before you were born again.
Amen.
But you got to understand it, you got to go back, see, to the creation. Now, the main person who doesn't believe Moses' account of creation, I'm thinking, cannot believe Jesus' words. Because he's speaking in view of the precision and accuracy of Moses' words. So if I don't believe his words, how can I believe? How can I believe Jesus' words? See, what about those that believe in a modified version of evolution? What about them? Do they believe in Jesus? Well, no, I choose to believe what Jesus said here.
Yes.
I know that he wrote of Jesus, but not by name. He wrote about Jesus as seen in the creation. See, that was he wrote about Jesus as in the commandments, as the moral image of Christ. See, the commandments were actually about Christ. This is the kind of person Christ would be.
Yes.
The Ten Commandments are a moral image of God. You are never authorized to act unlike God.
Amen.
Never. Mm-hmm. Yes, Brother Judah.
Before you get too far off of this point of creation, you said that the new creation is prefigured by the natural one. He also made the point that the natural creation was created in a fully developed and matured state. But that's where the new creation is unlike the natural creation, in that you have to grow up together into the head, which is Christ. He doesn't give everything to you all at once, but that shows the preeminence of the new creation over the natural creation, and that if you don't understand it, you won't be able to keep it.
Yeah, yeah, but everything was given to you, but it was in an undeveloped state. So you did receive everything. Just as surely as the complete DNA is complete, you received a complete divine nature, but it's developed by God's grace.
Yeah. Yes, the scriptures do say ye have received Christ.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. You have received him. Now, you've got to grow into that.
Mm-hmm. Now, the difference, as Brother Judah pointed out, the difference is the early creation didn't grow into that. We grow into it, but we received the fullness of what's required. You're not going to require anything else than what you receive when you receive Christ. But it's got to be matured. You receive grace to mature it. So that is, as Brother Judah pointed out, the difference. And then look at the Ten Commandments, as I mentioned. They're a moral image of God. But part of being in Christ is, and this is stated in Romans 8:4, the righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us. Romans 8:4. That's what it says. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Romans 8:4. So when you see the commandments, you in Christ Jesus are targeted to where this is simply is what you do. And the closer you are to God, the more you do it. Further you are from God, the less you do it. The commandments, the ceremonial law. The ceremonial law was the distinctions, the tabernacle service, the various washings and ceremonies they had, the clean and unclean distinctions. That's what is called the ceremonial law. In other words, under the law, because the law was written in your heart, God told you exactly how to live. Yeah. He told you what to eat, told you what not to eat, told you how to make your clothes, how to plow your field, when to be gathered together. Mm-hmm. See, spelled it all out under the law.
I think there was quite an advantage under that kind of a system, because a person really could not do anything without thinking about God.
That's right.
Uh-huh. Couldn't get dressed in the morning, couldn't eat, couldn't go to work, couldn't speak to anyone or deal with anyone on any kind of level without thinking about God, because that was all spelled out. But obviously the law was made to manifest.
There's still people that think that those ceremonial laws are in place. We've got people, dietetic professed experts, who they're not experts, all right, that go to the Levitical law and tell you that there was a reason why those meats were unclean. They simply and politely put, do not know what they're talking about. The only reason those laws were to be observed, the only reason was God said to do it. That's the only reason. There wasn't a logical reason or a physical reason. It was because that's what God was establishing. If I say to do it, you do it. Yes?
Now, I was thinking we've all probably been, I know I've been guilty of thinking in a law mentality, because instead of thinking about someone being born again, because you think you tell them, if you do this, if you do that, if you would just do this, well, they can't change unless they are born again.
Yeah.
So
this is for children. Now, for children, you have to do this.
That's right.
For children, but God has not made provision for a long childhood. It isn't so in the nature. It's not that way. And it's not that way in the spirit. A person has to grow up. He will not, God will not support a lifelong baby.
Yeah, that's right.
If you think he will, like you're gambling with your soul.
Yeah, that's right.
Not to be that way.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So the ceremonial law, and I want to go make the statement again. It taught Israel to do what God said to do, whether you saw the reason for it or not.
Yeah.
You did it because he said to do it, and there's still some things that the only reason you do it is God said to do it.
Amen.
Eventually, in Christ, you'll see the sense of it. That's something, the advantage we have, that have the Holy Spirit. Eventually, it'll make sense to you. If he says, don't join in conversations that are profitless.
Yeah.
Now you'd be surprised how many people don't believe that. Yeah. They jabber about stuff that's not important all the time. Mm-hmm. Don't do it.
Yeah.
Why shouldn't I do it? Just because he said not to do it. We don't have to give any other reason. There doesn't have to be any other reason.
Mm-hmm.
If he says be clean, be clean. Just because he said be clean.
Amen.
And you can maybe figure out a little more about it later on, but God taught that in the ceremonial law.
Yeah.
Their 100% of their life was ordered by God.
Yeah.
They did not have what we might call private lives. And then there was this, everybody said, he wrote of me.
Mm-hmm.
Then there was the sacrifices.
Mm-hmm.
The sacrifices were daily, weekly, monthly, annually. They reveal the various aspects of the one sacrifice that would be eventually offered for sin.
Mm-hmm.
Turtle doves, they represented like the tenderness and sensitivity of Christ. The bullock represented the strength Christ was offered. The sheep represented the leadability of, see, every kind of animal that was offered as a sacrifice represented some aspect of Christ. Moses wrote of him.
Yeah.
So when the sacrifice were designed, red heifers and lambs and bullocks and turtle doves and so forth, goats, Moses was writing about Christ.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And he was depicting him in the living creatures.
Yeah. Yeah.
What was actually being offered up to Christ. He offered up to Christ his mind as well as his body. His strength he offered up to Christ.
Yeah.
His sensitivity he offered up to Christ. See, everything he offered up to offer up to God, everything he offered up to him is all depicted in the in the sacrifices.
Amen.
The sacrifices were of varied size and strength. Because Christ is so complex, there was not one animal that perfectly described him. Then there was Moses, the promises. The promises Moses covered were the Abrahamic promise. He spoke of a one through whom the whole world would be blessed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That was a promise. He was writing about Christ.
Mm-hmm.
He said in Genesis 49:10, he recorded the words of Jacob, that to him shall the gathering of the people be. See?
Mm-hmm.
And through Deuteronomy, he said he's going to be a prophet that the people would listen to, and whoever didn't listen to him be destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
And through Moses, he also said that God would circumcise your hearts. See, there's some of the promises that Moses gave. See, in the grand scheme of things, Moses was preparing the world to receive Christ.
Yeah.
Amen.
The Jews in particular, and the Gentiles in general. You remove Jesus Christ from your considerations, you read Moses, and there's no need for Moses. We don't need Moses. He was preparing us for Christ, that Christ does have to do with how you live. Christ does have to do with how you order your life. God Christ does have to do with you obeying God. See, it does have to do with all those things. And so God taught people through Moses about these things that they'd rather not think about. But he taught them about it. The writings of Moses about creation, the fall, the flood, the scattering of Babel, the calling of Abraham, the creation of Israel, deliverance of Israel, a land that was promised, direction of Israel, sustaining of Israel. See, all of these matters were making the coming of Christ perceivable. If you can see, this is how God acts. He chooses somebody. He sustains them. He directs them. That's preparing you to receive Christ. We're being prepared to receive a Christ who sustains you, directs you, feeds you. See, all of that. And Moses prepared people for that kind of Christ. They enable us to comprehend something of the involvement of being a chosen people. Some people don't even recognize and don't accept that God chooses certain people.
Yeah.
We got a nation here, not to mention Abraham, the progenitor of the nation, that teaches us, well, God does choose people. Mm-hmm. Some say, no, he doesn't choose people. He chooses a plan. Mm. Well, God had a plan. I understand that. But he chooses people.
Yeah.
And Israel shows you that. Israel introduces you to God choosing a people.
Amen.
And that the people he chooses, he expects to follow him. Mm-hmm. He'll reward them for doing so.
Yeah.
He'll punish them not for doing so.
Yes.
See, it's lived out in the people. Moses, he spoke of me. Now, if you think of Jesus in respect to what is called the service of God in Romans 9, that's the whole tabernacle. The whole tabernacle service. Jesus is a total fulfillment of it all.
Yeah.
He's the tabernacle, the altar, the offering, the high priest, the candlestick, the incense, the Ark of the Covenant, the showbread, the scapegoat, the gatewell that took the sins away, and the fit man that took them away. He's all of those wrapped up in one person.
Amen.
That's how complex Christ is. And Moses, God chose Moses to introduce this kind of diversity.
Yeah.
See, can you see? It's marvelous when you see it.
Amen.
To have that kind of diversity. Mm-hmm. So when you think of Jesus, you don't think simplistically of him.
Yeah.
You couldn't think like a simpleton and be an Israelite. Life was too detailed. The directions of God were too detailed for a person to approach them simplistically. You had to watch out, don't touch that unclean thing. Well, look out, don't eat that.
Yeah.
There's a stranger at the door, don't forget to be hospitable. See, you couldn't live haphazardly.
Mm-hmm.
That's preparing people for Christ. Can you see it? That's preparing people for Christ. Christ said, Moses spoke of me.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I am.
Yeah.
And he's gracious in all of it, too.
Yeah.
Then Jesus adds, if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words? His writings. Now, Moses was an extensive writer. Before Moses delivered the law, God told him after he'd had the battle with Amalek, when Joshua commanded the sun to stand still, remember? God told him, the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua, for I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek under heaven. So that's some of his first writing. He wrote that account.
Yeah.
It is also written, Moses wrote all the words of the Lord and rose up early in the morning and built an altar under the hill and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. That's after he went up to the mount.
Mm-hmm.
He wrote down everything.
Yeah.
After delivering the Ten Commandments and the ceremonial law, to Moses, God said, write thou these words, for after the tenor of these words, I've made a covenant with thee and with Israel. So write this all out. And it apparently took him 40 days to do the writing.
Mm-hmm.
Later, as Israel went through the desert to Canaan, remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Moses wrote their goings out according to their journeys by the commandment of the Lord, and these are the journeys according to their goings out. So he wrote,
mm-hmm.
Moses wrote of me. Remember what Jesus said. Later it is said of Moses, Moses wrote the law and delivered it unto the priests, the sons of Levi, which bear the Ark of the Covenant, and to all the elders of Israel. So this is a lot of writing.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus wrapped it all up. He said, he wrote of me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now there's 38 references to Moses in the Gospels. 19 in Acts, 22 in the Epistles, and 1 in Revelation. 80 references to Moses. In Genesis through Malachi, there's 768 references to Moses.
Yeah.
That was the time of Moses. That's the period Moses is going to judge that.
Yeah.
That period. See, Moses wasn't just like a national hero.
Yeah.
That's not what Moses was. He wrote of me. God chose Moses,
mm-hmm.
who was faithful in all of his house, not only to issue the law, which came by Moses, but to prepare people to have an intelligent view of Christ.
Amen.
He established, he used him to establish and govern a people through whom the Messiah would come, and also in that government to acquaint people with how God governs his people. When they gripe, God doesn't like it.
That's right. Yeah.
I mean, we may get used to it. He doesn't like it. One time he complained and he just slew a lot of them.
Yeah.
When he provides food for them, he expects them to appreciate it.
Yes.
And to eat it.
Yes.
That's why he gave a man in the wilderness. There wasn't anything to be found anyplace else. Otherwise, those that didn't like manna, they'd have found some other herb to eat. There weren't any herbs out there. This is how God is. Paul used Moses' writings extensively in teaching the Gentiles. He wrote of me. Jesus said he wrote of me. So he couldn't do this. Paul couldn't do this if Moses didn't write of Jesus. He established that God has mercy on whom he will have mercy, and therefore salvation is from the Lord. That's Moses, the one that said that. He'll have mercy on whom I'll have mercy. He wrote that Moses described the righteousness that comes from keeping the law. Romans 10:5. He used Moses to establish the acceptance of the Gentiles.
Yeah.
Quotes from Moses. The principle of supporting the laborer, Paul wrote, was established by Moses. Paul employed the writings of Moses to describe the benefits of the new covenant. Paralleling with Hagar and Sarah. The glory that attended the giving of the law as recorded by Moses is compared to the glory of the new covenant. See, he's using Moses. Moses wrote of me.
Amen.
None of those things would be true if Moses didn't really write about Christ. You couldn't do that if Moses wasn't writing about Christ. But he wasn't writing about Christ in a real definitive way. He was in types and shadows, that sort of thing. This means Moses' writings are highly relevant to believers.
Amen.
Because here is a record of actual responses from God to both faith and unbelief. So you're learning about God. And Christ, that's who Christ is representing.
Amen.
Now then, he says, if you believe not his writings, how shall you believe my words? Now, that's a telling question, isn't it? If a person does not believe Moses' writings, how will they? What will enable them to believe the words of Jesus? If they don't believe the first principles, how are they going to believe the latter ones?
Yeah, that's right.
If they don't believe the introduction, how are they going to believe the book itself? See?
Yeah.
Now Jesus, he had considerable to say about his words. How shall ye believe my words? See, so he's very, my words. And he said some things about his words. They'll never pass away, he said that. My words will never pass away. He said, whoever is ashamed of my words, I'm going to be ashamed of him.
Yeah.
The person who hears his words and does them is like a man who built an indestructible house. The one who hears his word and believes on him that sent him has everlasting life. I'm emphasizing what he said about his words. If a man keep his sayings, he will never see death. His word will judge the one who receives it, does not receive it. If his words abide in a person, that person will ask what he will and it shall be done unto him. That's what it says. That's what Jesus said.
Amen.
Yeah. All on man's response to his words. All right. Jesus said, if you don't respond to Moses' words, do you really think you're capable of responding to mine? If you don't believe what Moses said, how can you believe what I say? You understand that there are multitudes of Christians that have no idea what Moses said. They're never exposed to it. In the Jewish synagogues, at least they read Moses and the prophets. At least they read it so people kind of become acquainted with it. There's a lot of people, a lot of preachers, hardly know anything at all about what they call the Old Testament. And some say, well, that's not for us. It was all nailed to the tree. Well, no, we got the king speaking here.
Amen.
He says, Moses wrote of me. How can anything, you know, how can anything, any writing about Jesus pass away? How is that possible? Jesus is an eternal He's eternal.
Yeah.
How can something that's said about him become obsolete? Amen. And Moses wrote about me. You can see the centrality of Christ's words. Not a feeling, that sort of thing. His words, what he says. It's estimated that in Scripture there are 2,026 words spoken by Jesus. All right, that's not a lot. You know, it's just a few pages. But all his words are weighty.
Yeah, that's right.
They're like a big tank compared to a thimble.
Yeah.
Of someone else's words. Mm-hmm. They contain a lot. The words he said that I speak are spirit and life. They have animating power.
Amen.
If you could ever get the word of Jesus inside you, it'll do something to you.
Yeah.
The spirit,
yes.
Animation, and life response. Great bodies of truth and reality are compressed into words.
Uh-huh.
Think of some of the words that Jesus used and how pregnant they are.
Mm. Yeah.
God. Holy Spirit, heaven, angels, eternal life, judgment, resurrection, never die. See, there are some subjects, just with a word.
Mm-hmm.
With a word, he introduced these vast subjects that some of us spend our lifetime probing into these things that were covered by a single word.
Mm-hmm.
Eternal life, a single word.
Yeah.
Brother Ricky led us to considering a discussion of that this last Lord's Day. See, big, Jesus said it in two words, eternal life. Oh. There was a lot in those.
Yes,
so when you say my words, don't think of word count.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
See, each of his words are so weighty. He didn't have to say a lot of words to reveal a lot of truth.
Uh-huh.
What about the word truth?
Yes, right, the truth. That's right. That's the truth too.
Yeah.
In fact, that was a fit description of Jesus himself, wasn't it?
Uh-huh.
So all of Christ's words were characterized by certainty and preeminence.
Yeah.
He never said a word that was going to become obsolete.
Mm-hmm.
He never said a word that was not a main word. They have what I've called animating power and authority.
Mm-hmm.
So we're living in a time when Jesus' words have been minimized.
Yeah.
Other men's words have been vaulted to prominence. So we got all kind of books. Walk through the religious bookstore and you'll find books filled up with words that were not spoken by Jesus, and some of them are actually in contradiction to what Jesus spoke. It's not uncommon to hear people supporting their cause by an institutional interpretation or sectarian phrase. So they want to make a point, so they quote some church father, or they spout out some saying that men created. See, they buttress what they're saying by men's words. When you got Jesus' words, and I would think, I'm prone to think that if the words of Jesus don't support what I'm saying, I probably should stop saying it. At least, if I do say it, I should say, well, this is my opinion. You know, I prelude it with that. According to Jesus' own words, the law and some say, well, the Gospels, I was among a group of people that a body of them believed this, that the Gospels don't pertain to us today. They were under the law. That's their way of dealing with leave thy gift at the altar and things like this. See, they're so ignorant they can't deal with things like that. But Jesus said the law and the prophets were until John. That's what he said. I said, that's what he said.
Yeah,
the law and the prophets were until John. From John the Baptist to Pentecost was an independent period, an interim period.
Yes.
That law wasn't governing in that period.
Uh-huh.
Which is why Jesus could have mercy on.
That's right.
Jesus could have mercy on people. Because the law wasn't operating at that time. Well, it doesn't mean it was right to murder. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that Jesus was governing that period and preparing for the coming new covenant era. The words of Jesus clarify the person of God. At some point, God's got to become more clear to us. We talk about God and the Father and Jehovah and all. We've got to have a clearer picture of God. The clearer that picture becomes, and when you first start out, it's not too clear. Not because enough hasn't been said, but because your capacities haven't been developed, and so you don't see much of God. So you, person who's new in Christ, if they're not taught properly, they'll accent all the time what you do, and you understand when you're a child that's necessary. But in that, there's got to be the tutors and governors have to say more than what they do. They've got to prepare them for adulthood.
Yeah, amen.
That's what you do when you raise your children. You prepare them. You prepare them for when they grow up.
Yes.
That's what we do with children of God. Mm-hmm. And Jesus, the point of Jesus' words here is that Moses' writings are like a primer. Mm-hmm. They're like a kingdom primer that acquaints you with God, acquaints you with the laws of God, what God requires, acquaints you with the coming of a Savior and why he was needed. We know he was needed because the chosen people went astray. So that tells you, all right, there was something fundamentally flawed in men. Because even after God chose them and blessed them and all this, they still went astray. Which means it was something was fundamentally wrong with man. Moses teaches you that. Then he tells you there's someone coming is going to correct this situation. And I thank God.
Amen.
We're living in that time.
Yes.
Hey, do you have a word you'd like to add tonight? Yeah. Yes, Brother Aaron?
Seems to be kind of a strange combination of what he said to these people about Moses. He said he trusts in Moses, but then they said, you don't believe Moses.
That's right.
Normally, if I trusted you, I'd believe what you said.
Yeah.
But I think the trust here, isn't it that they trusted, is more like a carnal security.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
That they trusted because they belonged to this lineage.
That's right.
That it's like they were covered or they were okay. But all the while, they didn't even believe what he said.
They assumed their association. Yeah. That's right. That's right.
Well, one of them said one time, we are Moses' disciples.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
See, Moses will judge them, see?
That's right.
Yeah. That accusation, unless they repented of it, uh-huh. That accusation we brought up, just think of this. That accusation we brought up, let's see, I gave you five talents. Mm. I gave you one. And I noticed that you didn't bring anything back here.
That's right.
With Moses, Jesus came and fulfilled the law,
mm-hmm.
which means he not only did what Moses said, but he fulfilled the spirit of what was said.
Yeah, amen.
And
amen.
Whenever, I'm having a hard time keeping my thought. Whenever he said, ye have heard it said, mm-hmm. but I say unto you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, if you can't keep Moses,
mm-hmm.
how are you, like, it? If you don't understand Moses, mm-hmm. if you don't believe what Moses said, how are you going to get any further than that? If you can't even get the, ye have heard it said, how are you going to get to, but I say unto you.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Yeah. I think there's men take great liberty when dealing with the writings of Moses. And I've even heard him say, well, these are just really just fictional stories. And they're just, you know, represented so that we can have some kind of a thought. And yet, Jesus, he's not ambiguous about this.
No,
it's pretty clear that you... If you don't believe, now, yeah. I don't have a complete understanding of everything that happened, but I know what Moses said. I know what he wrote. And it's written so we would believe it.
That's right.
And the anchor of our faith is that we believe that Jesus is God's son. Now, You can't do that if you ignore Moses. And,
that's right.
And this is, he's pretty clear on it.
That's right.
I mean, it's not like something that we have, well, if your opinion, like, what do you think about Moses? We don't have, who cares what you think about it? Do you believe? And I really like the fact that you tied this together with what he wrote about creation.
Yeah.
See, this is a big hot spot in our time.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just, you know, they're all over the board. They're proving they don't believe.
That's right.
They don't believe what Moses wrote. And they said, well, how could that be? Then ask you how it could be. Do you believe it? Because if you don't believe it,
amen,
you're on shaky ground.
Yeah.
And you won't believe it. Those people can't believe a new creation.
No.
See?
Yeah. Amen.
At all. Yes. Yes, Brother Judah.
This comment, the way he words the verse 45, it's almost sarcastic. He says, don't think I accuse you to the Father. As in, don't think I need to. You had an issue with Moses before you had an issue with me.
That's right.
So it's almost sarcastic there. But we also see in this text the prominence of Christ. Moses wrote of Christ. So we see that God was not improvising as he went along and working with what the people gave him. He had his plan. It was finished before the foundation of the world. So God knew what he was doing. And Christ was the centerpiece of what he's doing.
Mm.
So if Christ is that prominent in what God is doing, how much more should Christ be prominent in what we do?
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in your introduction, you were talking about how Jesus spoke. He comprehended what was being said. He could address that. You know, I was thinking that Jesus always speaks the truth, no matter who he's talking to.
Yeah,
that's right.
And, yeah, and he can address, he can do like no other man. He can address men on the thinking level, what they're thinking.
Uh-huh.
So he's the only man that can do that, and you can count on Jesus. Now some of these things we read was just we think you may perhaps, but he always says what needs to be said.
That's right, mm-hmm. Amen.
I mean, if he says it in a certain way, like it may appear to be sarcastic to us or a little harsh to us, but you can bet your money that's a way they need to hear it.
Yeah,
that's exactly right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why it's. It's better words than sarcasm. There are better words than that. See, these words like sarcasm, hyperbole, parallel, you know, there's some value in them, but they're not thorough enough. Because Jesus, he speaks with everlasting precision. That's why he doesn't have to say a lot of things, a lot of words. That's because he's speaking with pointed precision.
To be able to do, you know, speaking with our children or particular kids, want to be able to tell them the way it needs to be said in a particular tone and use the right words so to like cut through. But see, Jesus could do that.
Yeah, that's right.
If parents teach their children zealously and properly about the creation of God, how God created man, and so forth, they'll be less apt to buy into this evolutionary hypothesis.
That's right.
But some parents, they never teach, they just read little Bible stories and things like that. They never really tell them something substantive, like that dead people are going to be raised. Drive by the cemetery and tell them someday all the people are going to come out of those graves.
Yeah.
They won't understand it, but they'll know what you said.
Yeah.
And there will come a time when they will understand it.
Yes.
See?
Amen.
And that can't be said of something that's not clear and marked by certitude. Jesus spoke, you could hang your life on what he said.
Yes, amen.
Yeah. Well, I got a lot out of this myself.
I noticed this at Christmas time, we sat the kids down and asked them some questions. I noticed their comprehension of Scripture was very good. Very good. Their parents have given them a good foundation to work with.
Too.
I was blessed by their response, just of the Scriptures.
And people that visit here, they see this too. You, for you parents, other people see this. They know that this is not common. But they sense it ought to be. It ought to be common among Christian people, but it is not. And so it's a good testimony. And Jesus, God told the Israelites, says, read them to your children. When you get up, when you go to bed, put them on the wall, talk about them. Always bathe their minds.
Yeah.
in what God said. Yes, Sister Dita.
Back to what you were talking about. But Jesus was calling out that these particular Jews claimed to trust Moses, but they didn't believe the source of what Moses was talking about. He didn't believe the source. And that's the same thing in which we must consider Jesus by the source.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Who he really is. You can't separate someone from where they're getting their information or from who they are. You know, mm-hmm. You can't separate legitimately. And so for the Jews to say, well, we trust in Moses, well, they didn't believe the source. So when God in flesh came, they couldn't believe
that's
that
right.
either.
Uh-huh. That's right. Amen.
Mm. Yeah.
That's the power of tradition.
Yeah.
Mirror tradition. That's the
right.
power of mirror tradition.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Amen.
Right.